All right, we're getting started tonight. Book of Isaiah, we'll cover chapters 17 and 18. And should be able to get through those in a timely fashion and be able to answer any questions that you may have. But before we do that tonight, I just want to take prayer requests. Because I believe with all my heart, it goes beyond belief. I know. I know with all my heart that I serve a God that still answers prayer.
Amen.
He still is a miracle working God. I ask him to show up and show out.
Amen.
And that's, you know, people go, that sounds a little corny that you're at. No. I want God to show off his power. Show it. Let people know what he's going to do. He doesn't have to. But the more he does, the more people go, wow, I believe. Wow, I believe. And that's what I want to see. I want to see people believe in Jesus Christ. And so I pray every day that he shows up and shows out. And so show them what you can do. And I believe he showed us a little bit. And with everything going on in our world. But then on the other side of that, I believe with all my heart, he's also showing us how he protects his children and takes care of his children. We are blessed. We're honored to be in his house.
Amen.
And with that said, if you have a prayer request tonight, I'm going to just ask you to lift your hand and we'll take them before the Lord. We'll start right here, Ms. Trina.
Okay, so our service for my sister-in-law is in Oklahoma on Wednesday, so just pray for us as we travel. And we're doing the service ourselves. We don't have a minister or anything, so just pray that we say the right things.
Amen.
It's next Wednesday and Oklahoma. Okay.
So just travel mercies and prayers that it goes well.
Amen.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes,
for May.
Okay.
She fell. Apparently, she's been having dizzy spells, and she fell last night. I guess she's okay.
Miss Martha, I'm gonna have a little fun with you. May, my sister fell, and I guess she's okay. Okay, all right, that'll work. You sound like me and my brother. Truck backed over him. He's okay.
Take it off, girl.
Give up, walk it off, long way from your heart. Yes, ma'am.
Continue prayers for Mama and all the people that are in the nursing facilities. It's been a good while. Mama's birthday's May the 30th. And it looks like we'll be able to and so, you know, everybody's going through that as well. And so, but it's hard not being able to at least, you know, drop things off or see them every once in a while, you know. But we just talked to her on the way out. And she was so much better than she's been here lately. Spirits were up, and she's in a single room with one roommate. So they get out every once in a great while. So, it's hard on them, and we prayed hard. We didn't know with Mama's personality and stuff if she could make it, you know, being isolated. And a lot of people have worried that way, but we've been blessed, and we just continue prayers for everyone that are in those nursing facilities, those nurses, everybody that's taking care of them.
Absolutely, and birthdays. I've seen a lot of window sealed and front door birthdays.
Yeah.
Stand outside the windows and outside the doors. And
there you go.
I think the Gilberts did that just recently for Mrs. Gilbert. Celebrated her birthday. And so that seems to be real popular. We'll just keep moving around. Ms. Andy?
Steve, Denny, we have some pretty big stuff coming up here tomorrow and next Friday.
Then the Lord's with you, go get him, buddy.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's right.
Pray for Gerald's dad, who's got prostate problems.
Thank you.
Hold him up.
Okay. Brother Daryl Brennan, Daryl Linda, Daryl's dad, prostate problems.
Mary Jo.
Mary Jo. Yes, ma'am. There's one.
Speaking of nursing home, the facility my friend who's I take care of, they're basically test on the entire residence and all the staff. So pray
nasal passage to the back of the throat, that's all I know. And so I...
Leanne's husband showed it on video, he had to do it before rodeo.
Yeah.
They videoed it.
He was crying.
Yeah, it will.
Okay, my family, apparently this is a trend, because Stephanie fell a couple weeks ago, and her back, she was having problems with her back season, that they called a muscle problem. Anyway, she has ripped one of her muscles, so she's still going to work, but she's good.
Martha, just stay seated. Stay seated. Yes, ma'am, it's free.
Okay,
we'll do it.
Just for a brand new, just seems to be very depressed right now.
Anyone else? Yes, ma'am?
Prayer for our church.
I believe it is.
Thank you.
Just prayer for just the cover. God to cover our church. Amen. Everyone is protected. Everyone's safe. Get back.
I'll take that.
New normal.
Absolutely. And please, if you would, be so kind as to pray for Sharon, myself, and Jordan. We're going to get on the road Friday morning. I want to go early. You know, my wife is not early to anything. And she said, what time do you want to leave? I said, 4 a.m. She said,
No.
She said, I'm thinking more like 6.
And that's just getting up.
So, I'm thinking, never mind. But so pray for us. It should be an interesting day. We're supposed to drive in the rain most of the way, and so I want to get an early start and get going. We'll start when we start, and we'll finish when we finish. And I know it's all in God's hands and in His time. Amen. If you would pray for us, we appreciate it. Pray for Miss Emma.
Yeah.
That's one of the reasons we're going. She is just absolutely stirring, and to a point where this. You can tell when she's had enough, and she's had enough, and so we're going to try to relieve her of a little pressure and stress. If you want to remember some prayers. Anyone else? We're taking, yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I would like to continue our prayer for the young children who are coming down with this inflammatory syndrome.
Okay.
It's outside of coronavirus, but basically being abused, and a lot of young kids are getting sick out of it.
Right, the stomach ailments, and it's pretty rough on the kids. Anyone, guys, we'll just take your prayer request if y'all have any. Anyone else? All right, church, if you would, let's stand. Stretch out. Get the blood flowing so you don't go to sleep for an attention. And we're going to go to the Lord in prayer, if you would, bow with me. Father, I just thank you and praise you, Lord, that we can come into your presence. Lord, we can just stand before you with a humble heart. And Lord, we can just lift our voice in praise and glory and admiration unto you. Father, we just thank you and praise you. You're the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and you allow us in your presence. You allow us to draw close to you. You allow us to just find our peace and our comfort in you. And so tonight, Lord, I just ask that you would minister to each and every need that was mentioned here. Father, you heard every need, and you already knew the nature of those needs before they were ever mentioned. And so tonight we ask you, Lord, by your mighty and powerful hand, that in the name of Jesus you would touch and heal this body of believers. Everybody here, Lord Jesus, that has brought an infirmity into this building tonight, Father, I pray in Jesus' name, you will touch them, heal them, complete and whole. And I'm giving you praise and glory, Father, because I know that when you hear the word and you hear it lifted up to you, and we ask in the name of Jesus, I know it can be done unto us. And so, Father, I'm trusting and believing in you to be of your word and to minister healing to this body. Father, I just thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, I thank you. Lord, I just worship you tonight for the word. Lord, that we can come and we can just open our ears and our minds and our hearts before you and study and learn from your word. Father, I pray that you will give us clear minds. Lord, that you will give us understanding in our hearts. Lord, that we may apply this to our lives. And Lord, that it will be meaningful. Lord, not just words, but meaningful words that minister to our hearts. And Lord, that it will be a salve to our soul. Father, we just thank you and praise you tonight. We ask that you have your way in this service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I know the ladies started getting together and they had a good ladies group. I know the men got together. And this may be the one and only time, men, we had more men than they had ladies. But for me, that's like 1,000.
Amen.
A win is a win.
A win is a win. We'll take it.
Amen.
But we were blessed to get started in that capacity again. The quilting ministry, for them to get started again. We're just starting to see some of these things come to pass. And I know that there, this is what I'm going to say to you, and I'll say this, I won't say it this Sunday, but if you feel uncomfortable, if you feel that you need to wear a mask, or you've got certain,
amen,
you need to, by all means, if you need to stay home and watch it on recording, whatever you need to do, take care of yourself.
Amen.
I don't want you to worry. I don't want you to come to church with worry in your heart. I want you to just feel comfortable and at peace. And so do what you need to do to be at peace.
Amen.
But I know this, that when you come into the house of the Lord to honor him, his hand will be upon you.
Amen.
And we have to act responsibly. He gives us common sense in which to act responsibly. But at the same time, as we act responsibly, he will honor us.
Yes.
And he will touch our lives and our bodies, and his hedge of protection will remain around us, and we will be victorious. And I believe that with all my heart. And so I'm just glad to see our church taking back off. And we had a board meeting, and it was together.
Amen.
Wasn't on the phone.
Amen.
So it was great.
Amen.
And so we're getting back, getting some things accomplished, making some really, really good headway in the way that we're approaching things and doing things. And so I'm really, really excited about where God, I really believe this was a reset for us.
Amen.
I believe with all my heart for the Maxville Cowboy Church of Jesus to push the reset button. So I'm going to give you a chance to start over.
Amen.
So praise God, here we are. If you have the Bible, please turn with me to Isaiah chapter 17. We've had a burden against a number of different countries or nations or people, groups of people. And we've already determined this, but I'll say it again. When we say burden is a strong word for weakness. It's coming against you. You're going to be weak. You're going to fail. It's a burden. It's just overpowering to you. And so, I want you to be able to know that. It's a weight on a nation. Anytime I put a burden on you, I add a weight to you.
Amen.
Anytime I burden your life, I add a weight to your life. And when I add weights to you, I don't know about you. We got a new weight machine in our garage a couple of years ago. And we first got it, I hadn't lifted weights in years. And I got out there and I did my flexing after I got it all put together. And it was one of them bow flex machines. So I put, well, it was new to us. It wasn't new. But I put the little hook in all of the rods. And I put the little hook in the other rods. And I sat down there and I reached back and I grabbed the handles. And when I went to pull, it was like. So then what I did was I stood up and I pulled them out where I could get even with my body. And from there, I was okay. But if it was back here, it was like. And so I know the more weight you add, the more difficult, the bigger the burden.
Amen.
And it's harder to overcome. Because when I got a head start, I could overcome it. But behind me, I couldn't overcome it.
Amen.
And so I understood what it meant to be burdened. And many of you understand from many different ways. Maybe your job burdens you. Maybe your kids burden you. Maybe life burdened. Maybe your husband and wife burdened you. You know, honestly, some people in the church, it's a burden to come to church. They want to, and they desire, but it's just hard. By the time they get everything together and they get there, they're just ready for it to end. It took so much to get here. Sometimes church can be a burden. And that's why sometimes we go to church and we don't get anything out of it, because it was such a burden to get there. And God never meant for the church to be a burden. So when it's a burden, we have to look within ourselves. Same thing here. These countries, when these burdens fall upon them, they need to look within themselves, because that's usually where the problem lies. Beginning in chapter 17, verse 1, it says, "The burden against Damascus. Behold, Damascus will cease from being a city, and it will be a ruinous heap. The cities of error are forsaken. They will be for flocks which lie down, and no one will make them afraid. The fortress also will cease from Ephraim, the kingdom from Damascus, and the remnant of Syria. They will be as the glory of the children of Israel, says the Lord of hosts." We're in verse 4. "In that day it shall come to pass that the glory of Jacob will wane, and the fatness of his flesh grow lean. And it shall be as when the harvester gathers the grain and reaps the heads with his arm. It shall be as he who gathers the heads of grain in the valley of Rephaim. Yet gleaning grapes will be left in it, like the shaking of an olive tree. Two or three olives at the top of the uppermost bough, four or five in its most fruitful branches, says the Lord God of Israel. In the day a man will look to his maker, and his eyes will have respect for the Holy One of Israel. He will not look to the altars, the work of his hands. He will not respect what his fingers have made, nor the wooden images, nor the incense altars. In that day, his strong cities will be as a forsaken bough, and an uppermost branch which they left because of the children of Israel. And there will be desolation, because you have forgotten the God of your salvation and have not been mindful of the rock of your stronghold. Therefore, you will plant pleasant plants and send out foreign seedlings. In the day you will make your plant to grow, and in the morning you will make your seed to flourish. But the harvest will be a heap of ruins in the day of grief and desperate sorrow. Woe to the multitude of many people who make a noise like the roar of the seas, and to the rushing of the nations that make a rushing like the rushing of mighty waters. The nations will rush like the rushing of many waters, but God will rebuke them, and they will flee far away, and will be chased like the chaff of the mountains before the wind, and like a rolling thing before a whirlwind. Then behold an eventide trouble, and before the morning he is no more. This is the portion of those who plunder us, and the lot of those who rob us." We'll stop there, and we'll dissect 17. And I read it all because it's just easier to read it all than come back. As we know, as we started here, I'm going through my notes, as we start here, Damascus, first of all, is who this is directed to. Damascus is the capital city, if you will. It's the capital city of Syria during this time frame. It's an ancient city, and from the time of Solomon to the mid-18th century, there was fighting between Israel and Syria. Even as far back in Isaiah 7, it talks about that. It talked about how Isaiah encouraged Ahaz and Judah to resist the threat of the Syrian-Ephraimite alliance. And Assyria, under Tiglath-Pileser III, absorbed Damascus into its growing empire. So we know Damascus became a part of the Assyrian Empire. And now Damascus is being utterly destroyed. This weight upon it is going to destroy it. Verse 2, it talks a little bit about the cities of war being forsaken, that their flocks which will lie down and no one will make them afraid. That basically just talks about these great cities, and it really talks about Syria's southernmost influence. These cities are in the south, if you will. And this marks the southernmost portion of where Syria's influence reaches. And so we kind of have this demarcation line, if you will, of the Syrian influence. As we go forth in three begins to kind of explain into great depth. The fortress also will cease from Ephraim, the kingdom from Damascus, and the remnant of Syria. They will be as the glory of the children of Israel, says the Lord of hosts. Basically, the fortress in Ephraim, the city of Damascus, their glory will be just like that of the children of Israel. And just a few chapters ago, we learned about the children of Israel. They were utterly destroyed. So their glory was destruction. They didn't really have glory. But that was their glory, was destruction. So the glory here of Damascus and of the fortress of Ephraim will be the same. It'll be like the children of Israel. It'll be destruction. I'm telling you, we chose Isaiah because it had all these biblical promises in it. Those don't happen until the end of Isaiah, about the midpoint and further back. The first part of this talks about the children of Israel and the different nations around them and how God reigned on them in a mighty way to the destruction and desolation of their countries and of their nations. Moving into forces in that day, it's a future period that's kind of unspecified. It shall come to pass that the glory of Jacob will wane. First image of destruction. The first image of destruction in Damascus is what? Jacob, children of Israel, will wane. And understand this. The fatness of his flesh will grow lean. He's going to have a flesh destruction, the destruction of his flesh. So the very first idea of destruction is going to come in the flesh. You're going to see it start to destroy people. I'd liken that today to the COVID virus. The first image of destruction in this case for Jacob was that the fatness of his body grew lean. In other words, a healthy body become a lean, hungry, starving. Basically, his body just began to deteriorate. COVID just did it on the inside. Destroyed your lungs. I'm not saying that this is our first sign of destruction, but you could very easily make a case. Folks, open your eyes. First sign of destruction in the U.S. A great virus that destroys the body. Verse 5, it shall be as when the harvester gathers the grain and reaps the heads with his arm. It shall be as he who gathers the heads of grains in the valley of Rephaim. If you take a good hard look at that, let me turn the notes over here. You take a good hard look at that, a second image of destruction is that of somebody making a harvest. When you go through the harvest fields, yeah, you're harvesting and you're reaping what you've sown, but at the same time, harvesting is destruction to a field. I want you to think about that. When you go cut hay, when you get done, that field is destroyed. Now, it provides something else, but still, it's destroyed. And so they use this to remind us that the destruction is going to be just like a harvester going through and reaping his sow or his harvest in the fields. God is going to move through this city and reap from this city. He's going to take everything that he's sown from you. Think about that a minute. What else? Talks about the Valley of Rephaim. That was just southwest of Jerusalem. And I want you to hear the name of this. When this name is translated, it is Valley of the Departed. Valley of the Departed. I don't know about you, but that ain't sounding good. doesn't sound like a place that you want to just be hanging out right now. Verse 6 gives us a third image of destruction concerning the harvest of the olive tree as it was shaken and the fall of olives were eaten. But this image does show us that devastation is not complete and whole. In the cities before us, or in the nations before us, devastation was complete and whole. But this shows us here that it's not going to be complete and whole. And why is that? Well, let's read. Yet gleaning grapes will be left in it. Yet gleaning grapes will be left. Like the shaking of an olive tree, two or three olives at the top of the uppermost bough, four or five in its most fruitful branches, says the Lord God of Israel. That's what will be left. There will be a remnant. There will be a remnant. Not total destruction, but of the olive tree there will be a remnant. Of the grapes, there will be a remnant. And then, in verses 7 and 8, in that day, a man will look to his Maker, and his eyes will have respect for the Holy One of Israel. He will not look to the altars, the work of his hands. He will not respect what his fingers have made, nor the wooden images, nor the incense altar. In that day points to a time beyond judgment. Indeed, the judgment of God will cause a remnant to turn from false worship to the worship of the true God who created him. I want you to think about that a minute. In that day, what day is that? That's the day of judgment. When all this begins to come on them, then suddenly they will turn from these false gods that they've been looking at what they've been doing, what they've been building, what they've been making. And as they built these altars and they built these areas of worship, they begin to take pride in what they had done and what they had built and stood back and honored more of what they had built than what they were doing with what they built. I want you to think about something a minute here. I'm going to come back and preach a whole sermon on this. We might not even get through 18 tonight. Or we might just have to save that sermon for a week or two from now. But I want you to understand something. They were more proud of what they built than utilized it for what they built it for.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but that sounds like a whole lot of Christian people.
Amen.
They build stuff to honor God with it and then forget to honor God because they're too busy honoring what they built.
Amen.
That's exactly what these folks have done. And because of that, destruction had come upon them and judgment had come upon them. And then suddenly they went, hey, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I don't need to be looking at this. I don't need to be my mind set on this or my heart set on this. I need my heart and my mind stayed on Jesus.
Amen.
In this case, oh God, I'm sorry. He hadn't come to us yet in that form. But I need my mind stayed upon God. I need my heart and mind stayed upon Him. So in that day, they're no longer going to be looking at those things. But they're going to look to the true God. Get their mind off of what they shouldn't be worshiping and get it on what they should be worshiping. Ooh, you go a long ways with that one. I'm going to leave that alone right now.
Hallelujah.
Verse 9. In that day, His strong cities will be as a forsaken bough. And an uppermost branch, which they left because of the children of Israel, and there will be desolation. Signals the future time of judgment again. The reason for the abandonment of their cities is the Israelites, who, as in verse 10 explains, have sinned by forgetting God.
Amen.
The Israelites were really good about that.
Yes, they were.
God would profit them, they would do good, they'd be living the good life. And they would forget why they were living the good life. And the problem is the generation that went through destruction and got saved out of it didn't forget. That's why they continued to live the good life. And they began to tell their sons and daughters, the next generation. And they were able to live in the goodness of God. But about that second or third generation removed, the young ones begin to realize, we got this. You don't have to tell us, we got this. Technically, we know what we're doing. We're building things. We're making things happen. Hey, look, you guys just sit back, Honor the God of your God, and we got this. And they forget how they got where they're at. And so God goes, okay, I'm going to send a prophet to you. And in this case, the prophet's Isaiah is going to tell him, this is what I'm going to do to him. So Isaiah shows up and says, hey, the Lord of hosts says, if you don't get right and you don't start doing things right, he's going to destroy everything you got. I mean, there ain't going to be enough of you left for anything. They ain't going to be able to identify the ashes. And that's what the Lord of hosts says to you. And they go, all right, we got it. Run on. And for a moment, they give it a thought. But then they realize, if God was going to do something, he'd already done. I mean, we're doing well. Our country's in a good place. We're doing well for ourselves. So we got this. And they go on, and they continue doing what they're doing, and then the day of judgment comes. When God does exactly what he said he was going to do through the prophet. And when that happens, the first thing that happens is they go, oh my God, he's for real. He sent somebody to tell you. I mean, honestly, the children of Israel have got to be the dumbest folks I've ever met. I mean, they don't get it, they get it. They don't get it, they get it. They don't get it, they get it. Goodness gracious.
How about Americans?
Well, we run them a close second. But seriously, I want you to think about this a minute. All through the Old Testament, this was a continued phenomenon. It never changed. They would be taken. They would be enslaved. And God would deliver them from being enslaved. He would deliver them from the hand of those that had taken their spoils and their riches. And then he would even deliver back everything they lost to them. And they would go, oh, they will worship the mighty hand of God. And then a couple generations, they forget that mighty hand of God. Now, everybody in here over about 40 years old will go, I knew it was the young people killing them. And everybody young would say, nope, wasn't us. It was the devil.
Good times bring weak people.
Good times do bring weak people. That is a very true saying. Not in the Bible, but it is a true saying. And the reason being is because we're so busy enjoying the spoils of our riches that we don't take the time to build character in our young ladies and young men. And so that character slowly dwindles over time. And then we look at ourselves and go, where did it go? We allowed it to go. And so we're not that different from the children of Israel here in America today. We're fixing to, if not already, starting to reap some of what we've sown over the last 10, 30, 40 years. While we were busy beating our chest and telling everybody how great we were, and at some point we begin a deterioration.
The younger generations don't realize how hard what it took to get there.
Well, I'm not going to beat them up because that's not part of a lesson. But I will say this, you are correct, because most, I'm going to say everybody, the generation after Jordan's generation and Jordan's generation, and maybe even Ashley's generation, literally were given things because of the spoils of their parents. Their parents was able to do something that even my parents, a generation or two removed, couldn't do. And then, you know, Brother Woody, correct me if I'm wrong, or anybody else in here, that anybody over the age of 60 will tell you. At some point, they probably heard their parents say, because I want you to be better than me.
Amen.
And so they spent their life determining that we would be better than them. And then our job was to spend our lives determining that our children would be better than us. and so on, and so on, and so on. And when we do that, then what ends up happening at some point is our, because of the spoils of what we've got, we were able to give more and give more and give more, until pretty soon kids didn't even have to think about it or work for it.
As we do.
Okay, hold on. I got three at once. Sure, giving them something is not the problem. Teaching them what they got is.
I said that was our fault.
Our fault, okay.
It was our fault.
Our fault.
All I was going to say is it goes back to, you know, taking it back to the children of Israel. You know, the ones that suffered and did all the bad things and then God rescued them, whatever. They knew the bad times and got delivered out of the bad times to see the good times. So you go two or three generations of people doing what they're supposed to do and the children doing what they're doing, and eventually you have the same kind of scenario of, okay, well, everything's good. I don't know of anything bad, so nothing bad can happen to me, so do I really got to do what we're supposed to do? And we start down the path again of, hey, I got this. And we turn right back into a circle.
Well, you know, to kind of go along with that, one of the things that always think about is when we, some of the best Christians you'll ever have is people who never knew anything other than Christianity. They were born and raised in it. They lived in it. They never really got outside the church. They never really got out. I mean, they went to church, all that. That's some of the best Christians you'll ever know, because they never knew anything different. They never went outside that circle, and so they never were tainted. And then you have another group, and that's the group that was highly tainted. The group that was delivered from, they were delivered from the pits of hell. I mean, the devil was pulling at their heels while God was plucking them up like a hard onion. Literally, I mean, those make good Christians because they know where they come from and what they now have, and they appreciate that so much, they ain't going back there. And so that's the other group. The ones in the middle that don't have it so hard become the fence riders. On again, off again, on again, off again, on again, off again. Because they're mostly like the children of Israel. On again, off again, on again. You have the ones that were delivered from destruction from that remnant, and they know what they had. And then you had the ones who never departed. And then you got the ones that were on again, off again, on again, off again, on again. And that's probably 80% of them.
Well, it took, what, three generations of them to finally get into the promised land?
Pretty close to that.
Because they kept getting killed off? Because they kept denying their faith in God?
Well, you actually didn't even get killed off so they could go forward. Because they were stuck.
Yeah.
And honestly, I don't know. God had to bump them to get them there. And let me say this about that. Here's some of our problems. And this, you can translate this to the children of Israel if you would like. I don't know what they did in that day, but I'm just going to bring it home to you. And this is a this is a, I can't be exact because I don't remember the exact number, but it was very, very high. It was a poll of fathers, of sons in the United States. And this poll showed that the number was greater than 70%. I don't know what it was beyond that. But it was more important for those fathers to give their sons every opportunity to be a pro baseball player, pro football player, pro basketball player, some type of professional athlete, or some kind, something that they could be a star in. It was more important for them to do that than for them to give them a foundation in the church. And so when it's more, when you're telling your kid it's more important that you go 3 for 4 at the plate, or that you rush for over 100 yards in Little League football, when you're telling them that that's the most important thing, and then you expect later in life that they're going to go, going to church is the most important thing, I need to be there. Right. Not going to happen. They're not going to have that foundation. And when they don't have that foundation, when the day of judgment comes, they're going to crumble. And that's where we are as a people here. Now, I don't know what these fathers expected out of their sons in this day, but obviously not much. Because, you know, they face the same problems we do. I believe we're in verse 10. Yes, we are. Verse 10 and 11. Because you've forgotten the God of your salvation, have not been mindful of the rock of your stronghold, therefore you will plant pleasant plants and set out foreign seedlings. In the day that you will make your plant to, excuse me, in the day you will make your plant to grow, and in the morning you will make your seed to flourish. But the harvest will be a heap of ruin in the day of grief and desperate sorrow. God involves more than mental activity. He implies obeying and worshiping Him. To forget Him points to Israel's disobedience. Isaiah spoke of Israel's bad end by using a plant analogy. Israel worked hard to grow pleasant plants. They exerted their energy but ended up with a heap of nothing. You got to remember, they put all their energy into growing these beautiful gardens of plants. All for nothing. Isaiah warned them here, you may plant them, and in the morning you may see some progress, but in the end, you will reap a heap of ruin. You may spend every waking dollar you got to make your child an All-American. And you know what? For a time, you may see success. You may be able to be the father that stands on the fence after the game and everybody walks by and pats you on the back and goes, man, that kid is something else. That kid is great. That kid is wonderful. But let me tell you something. If you're not careful, you're going to reap ruin. It happens more than not. And so we have to be mindful of that, just as Isaiah is telling the children of Israel here. Verse 12, woe to the multitude of many people who make a noise like the roar of the seas and the rushing of the nations that make a rushing like the rushing of mighty waters. Woe is an oracle, a form of a funeral dirge, that the nations are agitated, they roared and raged as mighty waters, and often the image of social and religious chaos. In other words, they're basically saying all this noise coming out of there in the day of judgment is because they're in the midst of religious chaos. What happened to the God of our salvation? Well, you're not serving. Where is He at? He's supposed to save us. He's supposed to be our God. Well, He can't. He can't be your God because you wouldn't leave. I'm going to tell you, folks, the children of Israel, God's chosen people, are going to be no different in the day of judgment than the church, which is God's chosen children, His bride. And when He comes back to receive His bride, half His bride ain't going with Him. Because they've been too busy beating their chest and being religious. And they forgot to serve God. They've been busy serving man and religion and law and religious tradition. but forgetting to serve the God of that religion. Religion is just our way of trying to show God how much we love Him. But we end up tripping over all our rules. Man, we got more rules than God does. Go look at the tenets of faith of most denominations. They got more rules than Jesus did. He had 10. And we couldn't keep but about 3 of those. I want you to think about that. As you go down the 10 commandments, I want you to tell me. Don't tell me. Don't. That's rhetorical. How many of them you broke over your lifetime? There's a few of them that He made it really difficult to break. And those are probably the 3 that most of you have kept. But He had 10, and we messed those up. So what makes you think we're going to be able to come over here and make all these man-made rules that govern our denomination, and we're going to get those right? And then what those have caused in most cases is splits in those denominational churches. Based on the way we see those things. Because I can tell you right now, no 2 people really read the same verse and see it exactly the same.
Not everybody reads before and after either.
Well, yeah. That was the first thing I learned to do. And that wasn't even talking about the college. That was my granddaddy. He taught me sitting in his front yard, talking to the Jehovah's Witnesses. They'd come up to the fence and he'd be sitting there with his Baptist standard and his Bible, or his Sunday school book and his Bible in his lap. And I thought, oh, this is going to be good. Can we talk to you about religion? Or sometimes they would say about Jesus. Absolutely. Come on in. Have a seat. And he never once raised his voice. He never got argumentative. He never needed to. He knew what he believed. And he stood firm in that. And when they would read him some scripture, he would tell them, and I remember this, and I quote, "Boys, that sounds good. Now read 2 or 3 verses in front of it and 2 or 3 verses behind it.
There you go.
And we'll put some real meaning to this." And he'd smile. And it never meant the same when you read it all. And that's where I learned that. I didn't learn it in Bible college. And he didn't even charge me for it. And he didn't charge me. But that's what I learned. And so if you're going to use the Bible, use the whole Bible. Can't pick and choose parts of it. A lot of Christians today want to pick and choose their parts of the Bible. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. They love that one. But they can't hardly stand for all of sin to come short of the glory of Christ.
Amen.
They struggle with that one. You got to use it all for the glory of the Lord. Whew, 13. The nations will rush like the rushing of many waters, but God will rebuke them, and they will flee far away and be chased like the chaff of the mountains before the wind. And like a rolling thing before a whirlwind. Though the nation rages, God's rebuke will be quiet through the driving of them away. Chaff is light, and the wind blew it away. God's rebuke will blow away the tumultuous nations. God doesn't have to make a lot of noise. He don't have to show his. God does not have to show with noise. Now, boy, am I fixing to irritate some people. God don't have to be noisy in a church house to be moving. God can move in still, quiet places. He can move in the stillest of hearts. He don't have to put on a show and an altar for you to know He's moving. The glory of a saved soul lets you know God is on the throne and He's moving. A healed heart, a healed leg, a healed mind, a healed set of lungs. I have a brother in the church that shared with me that he had stage 4 lung cancer. He had went through chemo. And he and his wife never really went to church. She wasn't very religious. She believed in God, but really didn't want to go to church. Didn't believe in the church. So he kind of got away from it. And after she passed away, a couple of years had passed, and he was diagnosed with cancer. And went through chemo, and they basically told him ultimately he was, due to the chemo and everything, he was going to end up losing his voice. He wouldn't be able to talk. And that was, I think, a little over a year ago. And he's continued to go back and get shots and some different things. But he told me, he said, I found the church. And he said, I believe with all my heart. I'm still here today because of the work God did in me in that church.
Amen.
He said, I believe I'm still talking to you on the telephone. I haven't lost my voice yet.
Amen.
I don't know about you folks, but that's God showing up.
Amen.
Wasn't no show. Wasn't nothing. Didn't have to do anything crazy. Didn't have to get wild. God showed up.
Amen.
If God wants to do it, he will. If he wants to show up big and he wants to split the ceiling, he will. But he don't have to move. And the quietness of one of those round tables out there, I watched a man's heart go from racing to slow.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Not an issue, because your pastor wasn't obedient.
Right.
I just put my hand on my shoulder and prayed for him. And the Lord said, I didn't tell you to do that. He showed me his little watch again, had his heart beating. Lord said, I told you. I told you to anoint him with oil and pray for him.
So be it. Yes, so be it.
So I went in the kitchen because I didn't have any oil. And you go, you I know, just like my wife did, you're probably going, you know, Lord, you know, men standing out here, and I don't want to embarrass the guy, you know. Come on. Do what I told you to do.
Thank you, Lord.
So I gotta go find some oil now. So I went in the kitchen and I filled with a big bottle of oil. So I don't want to drown you. So I got a napkin, got some on it, got one for me. Went outside and I did exactly what God told me to do.
Amen.
I poured in the oil and I began to pray over him.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
And it probably wasn't 5 minutes, he showed me his heart rate on his watch again. His heart rate had dropped to a nice, even 62, 63, whatever it needed to be, whatever the good place for it. When you do what God tells you, you don't have to put on a show. Just be obedient. He didn't ask me to stand on the table and pray for him. He just asked me to anoint him with oil and do what the Bible says, son. So, you know what he taught me in that? Get the oil out. I was just anointing the oil and lay on hands, so I get the oil out.
That's right. Amen.
And I believe with all my heart, God's not done in this church. You're going to see greater humans.
That's right.
You're going to see bigger humans.
Amen.
You're going to see people come specifically for you because the word's going to get around you.
Amen.
You know what? And that church will pray for you.
Amen. That's right.
And you're going to get healed. They'll pray for you and you're going to meet Jesus. They'll pray for you. Jesus is going to do great things in your life.
Yeah.
That's what I desire more than anything else.
Yes.
I don't want to get caught up like this group. I don't want to be here when Christ comes back to receive his bride and go, man, I wouldn't take you across town, much less to heaven with me. My pastor that I kind of look up to over in Hawaii, Brother Wayne Cordero, he always says, I want to be a church that God finds joy and praise in his heart for.
Amen. Amen.
I want God to look at the church and go, that's my church.
Amen.
That's what I want. I want to be the example, he says to the other churches. Look, this is what this is the whole point. This is what Paul preached and ultimately died for. This is what Paul was in prison for, to see things like this. Because this is where I can do a work. Everywhere else I'm having to work in the church or on the church. I want to work through the church. God to have to spend all his time working on our church. I want him to spend his time working through our church.
Amen.
What's that got to do with anything, Brother Joe? I got the microphone.
Yeah.
14. God's judgment comes quickly. And we see that here. It says, then behold, at eventide trouble, and before the morning, he is no more. This is the portion of those who plunder us, and the lot of those who rob us.
Right.
We'll have to finish 18 next week. Because we just ain't going to get there tonight.
Hallelujah.
If I did, you wouldn't be happy going home in the dark. But there's some folks that might be. I just, honestly, folks, as I read this, as I watch through the book of Isaiah, I just see the unfolding of the church in the United States. Us, the chosen children of God today. It scares me. It scares me for the people. My heart is broken because I don't want to see anybody not saved. I don't want to see anybody that perishes not knowing Christ. One of the worst places you could ever be. To be dying and not be able to do anything about it. Or to pass from this life. One of the scariest things I ever had, you know, I've had a whole lot of incidents happen in bull riding. I've had some accidents that I probably shouldn't have walked away from. But none of them in the moment scared me. Like an incident of dehydration with my body shutting down. When I had absolutely zero control of my body, zero control of my mind, I couldn't function. All I could do was listen to people try to help me. And listen to the continuing sad story that they were speaking to each other. And all I'm thinking the whole time I'm sitting there is I feel like I'm in a dream, sitting above myself, looking at myself, dying. Because I didn't know what was going on with me. All I knew was I was more out than in. And the longer they would work on me, I looked at the fireman who was holding me up in the chair, and I said, now I'm going to pass out again. He goes, go ahead, I got you, guy. And I remember my eyes rolling back in my head, and I just, I'm going to tell you right now, if I had left this earth in that moment, I was okay.
Amen.
But what about somebody who's not?
That's right.
They don't have time to get right. Because you ain't thinking about getting right right then. You ain't even coherent. You can talk some when you're in, but when you're out, you're just there. That's a scary place to be. And when I think about that for somebody who does not know Jesus, if you're literally dying, that's it. If I had never come out of there again, I'd have been okay.
Amen.
But what about somebody who's not prepared? What if I had been there, standing there beside somebody who was at the table and that was happening to them, and they did not know Jesus Christ? I can't pray them into heaven as much as I'd want to. Maybe I can lead them, maybe I can't. Because right now, you've got 20 people talking to them, trying to get them just staying coherent. I want you to think about that, folks, because you don't know where you're going to be when that time comes. You don't know the condition you're going to be in. And if you're not prepared, you may not have that opportunity. Get yourself right with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
But for the grace of God, I could have died as a teenager numerous times. I could have died in my 20s numerous times. Thank God the 30s wasn't as bumpy. But I'd also begin to turn the life around through Jesus Christ at that point. but for the grace of him bringing me through those early years. And I'm proud to be where I am today.
Amen.
But my fear is for those who aren't. My fear is for those who are thinking I got time. I'll get it done somewhere else down the road. Man, why do you want to take a chance? Man, I don't know about you. I want to serve this great God.
Amen.
I want to serve this God that makes a difference. I want to serve this God that can do the unthinkable.
Amen.
Good or bad, he can do the unthinkable.
Amen.
I want to serve a God who can heal me. When there is no healing, he can heal me. When there is no antidote, when there is no vaccine, he can heal me.
Amen.
I want to serve that God.
Yes.
I want to serve a God who says, you know what? I ain't done with you. Get back up and get on your feet. Get back in the game, son. I'm not done with you.
Amen.
I want to serve that God.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I don't know about you, but as every day he gives me breath in my body, I want to use it for his glory. I don't believe in this better than I deserve stuff.
Nope.
A lot of people use that, and that's wonderful, that's great. Better than I deserve. If it was better than I deserve, I wouldn't have it. God gives me exactly what I deserve. And sometimes he doesn't give me what I deserve. Sometimes he lets me slide without reaping what I should get. So when somebody asks me, how you doing? If the response is needed in that moment, God gives me something to say. Blessed and highly favored.
Amen.
Ooh, I'm blessed and highly favored.
Hallelujah.
Because I believe that with all my heart. I'm blessed and highly favored.
Amen.
When I look around, I'm blessed and highly favored.
Yes.
And so that's a great place to be. And that's where I desire everybody in the church to be. I want them to be able to say, I'm blessed and highly favored.
Amen.
Brother Mike, do you still have a song back there that you looked up for me?
Somewhere.
If you'll play it, we'll finish with that tonight. I'll give you a second. Tell me when you got to give it a thumbs up. You give it a thumbs up and I'll shut up. No, I'm not going to say it. No. I promise you that. I want you to sleep tonight.
It's called greatly blessed, highly favored, and imperfect, but forgiving. Yes. Oh, you were going to say already?
Highly favored and imperfect, but thank you.
out there with the hats on his head.
It was Mark Lowry.
Part of the Gaither Trio started it, and then the Gatlin brothers joined them, and then the Gaither Trio finished it. I guess they all finished it together. But that was, when I found that song, that became kind of my theme. And for several mornings, I would listen to that going to work every day. And I'm going to tell you, you listen to that going to work, there is no way you can go to work in a bad mood. There is no way you can go to work in a bad mood when you think about that. Greatly blessed and highly favored, imperfect but forgiven child of God. Ooh, that's about as plain and simple. That's a theme song. Ooh. We might have to teach that to our singers.
There you go.
I think they can get it. We can sing along to it really good. We can even get rodeo and boom, boom, boom on the drums and get that kick beat going, and all we got to do is just sing along.
Amen.
I'll see y'all all four on Wednesday night. Y'all got to help me convince a Sunday morning crowd. Woo! All right. Now, if you would stand with me tonight. I know nobody wants to go home, but we can't stay here.
Amen.
I want to ask if you would to join me in prayer. Please remember, this Sunday morning, Brother Wayne is going to be standing in the pulpit. Our singers will be here. They'll be singing away, singing their hearts out for you. And Brother Wayne is going to deliver the message of God. And I'm going to tell you, Brother Wayne, thank you. He gave me a CD, and it will take you back in time. I listened to it coming home. It's your grandpa, right?
Yes, sir.
It's his grandpa preaching on the radio. And I think it was what?
Radio broadcast 15.
Who sang? Who sang?
My aunt, Aunt Tootsie.
Yes.
And my dad's youngest sister.
She sang two songs on the radio. One of them was Harvest Time.
Amen.
And it was old school radio, brother. I'm telling you.
And it made you shout.
It was. It took me back to a whole other place. Ooh, back to old KTBC down in Austin. You can hear it coming to you live.
Amen.
And that was good stuff. And he preached about the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And,
hallelujah.
15 minutes to heaven. And that was, praise the Lord. Thank you for that. But you can listen to Brother Wayne. Because you can hear his words, and you can hear even the mannerisms. And so you know there's good seed there.
Amen.
And so that's why I feel totally comfortable and confident in him standing in his pulpit and listening to the word of God. So that being said, I know the Holy Spirit will lead him, and you will be blessed and honored.
Amen.
And you know, just can't wait. Please be here, be a part of it. You will be blessed. Let's go to the Lord tonight in prayer. Father God, we just thank you and praise you because we are greatly blessed and highly favored. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your goodness and your mercy in our lives. Thank you, Father, for continuing to just love us when we're unlovable. Thank you, Lord, for guiding and directing our paths, for leading us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Lord, I just thank you and praise you tonight that I have the opportunity as a sinner to know you and my sins be forgiven. To have you as the Lord of my life, to lead me and direct me and guide me. Father, I just thank you tonight that you are the God of miracles. You are on the throne. You are alive. You can still do something for your children. All these jobs that people want to put their time, money, and effort into, they can't do a thing for them. You're a God that's alive and well. You're saving souls. You're delivering people. You're breaking their bondage in their lives. You're setting them free from drugs and alcohol and all kinds of addictions. You're setting them free from sickness and bondage. And Father, I just thank you and praise you tonight that you are real and on the throne. Father, I just ask you tonight to have your way in each of our lives. Let your blessings rest upon us. Father, just continue to prosper us. And continue, Lord, to just guide and direct the path of our lives. Father, we just turn our eyes and hearts upon you, and we just give you praise and glory in Jesus' precious and holy name. And everybody said,
amen.
God bless you. We'll see you on Sunday.